What's up, everybody? Welcome back to my channel. If you're new, hey, I'm Sydney. Every single Thursday, I sit down and I talk about the craziest true crime in every single state, the one that stuck out to me the most. So if you like true crime, you should subscribe. Do I look like a witch today? I feel like I look like a witch today. I don't normally wear dark colors, but I kind of like it. Kind of sets the mood, I guess. Yeah, so welcome back to True Crime Thursdays. Last video I posted was a new case, so if you didn't go see that, it is now my previous video. It is actually in a new playlist, so go check that out if you haven't seen that. Sorry I haven't posted. Explained everything in that last video, so another reason for you to go watch it. Today's video, I have to give a disclaimer myself because it's actually very dark and twisted and gross. This video kind of focuses on child molestation. So if that is something that triggers you, please do not watch this video. This is my disclaimer to you, just to better your mental health by not watching this video because it is so dark. This man was twisted and he did so many bad things to so many children. Please don't watch this video if that is something that angers you or triggers you in any type of way. Just be cautious of that while you're watching this video. I haven't done anything like this so far on this series. This focuses on a priest named John, who, like I said, was absolutely disgusting. Today's video is in the state of Massachusetts. And yeah, let's just get right into it. Before we begin, there's a lot of hard names in here and hard words for me to explain, but I did research how to say these names, and I'm just going based off of the pronunciations that I heard while listening. So if I mispronounce something, please don't come for me. I'm really sorry. I'm trying my hardest. John Joseph Geoghan was born June 4th, 1935 in Boston, Massachusetts to an Irish Catholic family. When John was 5 years old, his father passed away, so he had to move in with his uncle, who was Monsignor Mark Keohan, who was a part of the Archdiocese of Boston. While John was at his father's funeral, a lot of his family members were telling him that he shouldn't be sad, his father's in heaven, and this sparked a really long interest of wanting John at a very young age to become a priest and be really a part of the church and just grow into the church and have a job in that. In 1952, John graduated from Holy Cross High School and then went on to Cardinal O'Connell Seminary right after high school. In 1954, Reverend John Murray did an assessment on John Geoghan and said that he had a lot of pronounced immaturity and he didn't believe that there was going to be a lot of satisfactory work in the career path that John was taking. So because of this, John left that seminary and then went to Holy Cross College, where he eventually graduated in 1957. After graduation, he went to St. John Seminary and was ordained in 1962. If you are focused on what seminary school is, it's basically the same thing as a Bible college where you focus on the Bible and ministry, but the seminary school is almost like a graduate school. And Bible school is like the undergraduate. Seminary school focuses more on ministry with like pastors and missionaries and evangelists and things like that. So he basically did his undergrad and then got ordained. So from 1957 to 1962 was when he was in seminary school. I'm really trying because there's so many different names to describe Christian colleges and stuff. So please, again, bear with me. Please. February 13th, 1962 is when John was assigned assistant pastor at Blessed Sacrament Parish in Saugus, Massachusetts. December of 1962, there was a man that was threatening to commit suicide off of the Mystic River Bridge. He was going to jump off of it and end his life, but John talked him out of it and saved his life. John was described as a very outgoing person, and he liked to make people believe that he was actually really interested in their problems and was just a master manipulator. He only really wanted to focus on the young boys and was very sympathetic to young boys. In the 4 years that John was at Blessed Sacrament, Reverend Anthony Benzovich told church officials that John would bring young boys into his bedroom multiple times, but then later went on to explained that this never happened. He denied that he said any of this. September 22nd, 1966 is when John was transferred to St. Bernard's Parish in Concord, Massachusetts. Randomly, with no explanation, was transferred again only after serving 7 months there on April 20th, 1967 to St. Paul's Parish. So nothing really said, but we can kind of start to get the hint of why he was transferred only after serving such a short amount of time. In 1968, that church received a complaint that there was a man that caught John molesting his son. Other parents also made the same accusations. Because of this incident, John was sent to Sitton Institute in Baltimore, Maryland to receive treatment. In the early 1970s, John was introduced to Joanna McLean and would visit the family frequently, because she had four young boys. The youngest of the boys in 1974 told his mom that John would make him engage in multiple sexual activities, and that John was explaining to this kid that it was completely normal. All of the boys, the brothers, confirmed this, saying that it was either all of them individually or he would make all of them do sexual activities together with him. Joanne explained that John would take the boys out for ice cream and give them baths and also read to them before bedtime, so it could have happened at any of those times. Joanne took all of her boys to St. Mary's Church in Melrose to basically complain about the assault that John had performed on her boys. But Reverend Paul E. Maselli wanted to keep this hush-hush, make it a secret, and didn't want this to go public. He asked her to please don't say anything about this. We need to keep this on the down low. Later, the Reverend Paul E. Maselli denied that this even happened, even after Joanne and the church had settled after a lawsuit from the archdiocese. Joanne sued the archdiocese and won, and then he still had the nerve to say that this never happened. June 4th, 1974 is when John moved to St. Andrew's Parish in Jamaica Plain. This is where he would offer a 13-year-old boy a job to work at the church, and he would repeatedly fondle this boy. This boy was the fifth out of six children, and the family was very poor, so him having this job really helped the family out, so there was really no way out of it for him. A complaint was finally made about John to Reverend Francis Delaney, but he dismissed this complaint and even wrote a letter basically explaining that this never happened. So all of these reverends are trying to keep everything that this man is doing a secret and not really confronting him about it. They're just letting him transfer from different churches to different churches, having multiple complaints about him touching young boys. They're throwing away the complaint letters and keeping it a secret and denying everything. Bishop Thomas Vose Daly did do an investigation on John and these accusations, but acquitted him after only one phone call. It didn't say exactly what he said about the phone call, but I guess John manipulated him into believing that none of this was going on. He was like, yeah, you know, John couldn't have done any of these things. After one phone call, you can't even like look at this man's demeanor and actually see his body language and stuff. It's just, you can change your voice many different ways, especially on a phone call. But John admitted to Reverend John E. Thomas that he did molest seven boys of the Dusard family. Bishop John Thomas sent John Geoghan on a paid sick leave, where John received psychotherapy and underwent a psychoanalysis, even after explaining he didn't believe that John really needed these things. This bishop didn't believe that John had a serious or pastoral problem. This man is molesting boys and you don't believe he has a problem? February 25th, 1981 is when John was sent to St. Brendan's Parish in Dorchester, but this is where he allegedly raped and fondled multiple children, also at an ice cream shop in Jamaica Plain. A distressed woman who had a nephew molested by this Catholic church wrote an article titled Sex Shame in the Catholic Church. This article gained a lot of popularity and captured the attention of the new Archbishop Bernard Law, and he told this lady that everything is being investigated at the moment and appropriate pastoral decisions are being made regarding John and the molestation. There were so many complaints about John that this new Archbishop Bernard Law had removed him from this position but transferred him to St. Julia's Parish in Weston. Why is this man still a part of the church? at this point, there has to be at least 100 complaints about this man, and they're still covering him up and not sending him to jail. One of the main victims in this article was in 1986, when a boy who had just tragically lost his father to suicide, John went and picked this boy up to take him out for ice cream, and as he was reaching down this boy's pants while pleasuring himself driving, he was telling this boy how sorry he was about what his father had just done. And the boy said he was so shocked and so scared that he didn't even eat his ice cream. It just melted all down his arm. How sick do you have to be to do something like that? Another victim, who was 14 years old, was raped by John in the changing room of the Boys and Girls Club. And he said that he saw John a month later and he immediately burst into tears, and it brought back too many terrifying memories for him. He said he remembers John was wearing a priest collar, so whenever he witnessed John along with the priest collar a month later, that's whenever he kind of made the connections. So after many, many complaints of John molesting boys, somebody, and it didn't say who, but somebody made the wonderful decision to put John over three youth groups. December 7th, 1984 is when Bishop John Michael D'Arcy complained to the new Archbishop Bernard Law about John, but this Archbishop told John D'Arcy that John was fully recovered and everything was fine. He's good. He's not going to do anything to the children. New allegations of child molestation began to resurface in 1986. So John was sent for treatment at St. Luke Institute in Maryland, where he was diagnosed with homosexual pedophilia. Diagnosed! April 28th, 1989 is when Bishop Robert Joseph Banks ordered John to leave the ministry. John was sent on a sick leave and was transferred to the Institute of Living in Hartford, Connecticut for many months. When he was discharged, the summary explaining why he was discharged showed that he had moderately improved. This improvement was ended when he was found proselytizing with a boy in a pool in 1991. In 1993, John formally retired as a priest after 31 years and was sent to a residency where retired priests could live and stay. Kind of like an old folks home, I guess, what I was reading. It's basically assisted living for retired priests. 3 years later, after more allegations surfaced, he was sent to Ontario, Canada for more treatment. The doctors at this center basically explained that John, under no circumstance, should be left alone with any boys unsupervised and should have no interpersonal contact with any males at all. Sorry, not any males, any male minors. Even after retiring in November of 1994, a woman basically explained that John had molested all four of her young boys, a completely separate woman from the one that I mentioned way earlier with her four boys that he would like bathe and take out for ice cream. She explained that he molested her four sons and would make really bad phone calls to them, obscene phone calls to them, but John didn't care. He was just like, I'm just gonna get away with it like I have been, which shouldn't have happened in the first place. In 1995, John attended the christening of a young girl, and this is where he fondled her brother. No therapist could say that they could help John control his urges, and this is where John explains that he targets children in poor families because they're really affectionate and he fed off of that affection. No other boys from middle-class families and high-class families would give them that attention and affection, so he was wondering why it was so different with the poor-class families, and that's why he targeted them more. He was confused why the middle-class and high-class family boys did not want to be around him. In 1998, the Boston Archdiocese had to pay up to $10 million due to John's molestation. Cardinal Law flew to Rome to ask if this priest could be relieved of his collar, and he didn't want the defrocking process of him no longer being a part of the Catholic Church to be as long as the judicial process takes, so he wanted to make sure that this was irrevocable, like this was going to be it, and that this needed to happen very fast. December 2nd, 1999 is when John was indicted by a grand jury for indecent assault and battery. This specific charge was of John putting his hands down the 10-year-old boy's pants at the Boys and Girls Club And at the time that this trial was taking place, this boy who was the victim was now a college student. A week later, the Suffolk Superior Court indicted John for repeated rape and molestation charges. March of 2000 was when Judge Sandra Hamlin gave John the max sentence for all of these charges, which was only 9 to 10 years. And he was eligible for parole only after 6 years. She said it was because she was disgusted that he was in a position of trust and he degraded that trust. So if you were disgusted by it, why did you only give him 9 to 10 years? I know that that was probably, like she said, the max sentence. But why is the max sentence so low for multiple repeated rape and molestations? I forgot to mention that in 1998, John was defrocked by the Pope John Paul II. So he was defrocked. That's good. So not only was John a serial rapist, but he got away with all of this for over 30 years. There was over 150 children, mostly boys, but there were a few girls, and all of the reverends and bishops just kept transferring him to multiple different churches where there are other multiple different children. Make it make sense. And he got away with it for 30 years. He was 67 at the time he first went to prison for all of this. But it doesn't end here, okay? I know this video is so long, but I'm covering 30 years, okay? But it doesn't end here. Here we have Joseph Druce. We're not going to go into Joseph's childhood because this video is going to be an hour long, but in 1988, he was given a life sentence for being a convicted murderer. The victim had picked Joseph up while Joseph was hitchhiking, and Joseph said that the victim made a sexual pass towards Joseph and it made him uncomfortable, so he killed him. Joseph was placed in a correctional facility in Lancaster, Massachusetts, and it is also said that Joseph was a victim of child molestation as well by 3 older men while he was a kid. This is something that he didn't really talk about, but it did anger him a lot, what happened to him when he was a kid. Joseph was known to be rabidly homophobic and was a part of a white gang in prison, the Aryan Brotherhood. This gang was a very racist gang. So after John's conviction, he was placed at the same facility with Joseph Druce. He was initially sent to a medium security prison, but guards and other inmates were attacking him for being a child molester. Prisons don't really like child molesters. So he was sent to the protective unit that Joseph was also at. So it's like, yeah, let's protect a man who molested multiple children. Let's protect him at all costs. He's a good guy. So while in this prison, John bragged about the ways that he would molest these kids and how it was so easy for him to do all of these things to these children. He also explained that his appeal against his conviction was going to work out in his favor because he was a priest. And whenever he's let out, he's going to go to South Africa and work as a missionary for children. However, he still remained to be very religious and told his attorney that he was excited he got to spend so much time in his cell so he could spend more time praying. The fact that John was being a cocky rapist absolutely sent Joseph to really crazy rage where he just saw red. And this is where Joseph, on August 23rd, trapped John in his cell with a book by jamming it so where no one could come in. Joseph bounded and gagged and strangled John with his bed sheet. Then while he was laying on the floor, Joseph would jump off of the bed onto John's body multiple times and then beat him with his bare hands after John had already passed away. During this time, multiple officers are trying to get in the door, but it's so stuck and jammed they couldn't pry it open. And this is when Joseph was telling him, no need to come in and revive him, he's already dead, no need to hurry, everything's good in here. There were multiple officers and nurses trying to revive John, but it was clear that he was already dead. John's cause of death was ruled as ligature strangulation and blunt force trauma to the chest. January 23rd, 2006 is when Joseph was charged for the death of John Geoghan. And this is when he explained that he doesn't really feel any remorse for it because of all of the bad things that John did. He said that there were so many thoughts racing through his head, basically explaining that he needed to stop this. Joseph also explained that he would ask John multiple questions and John would just reply out of pure arrogance, and this angered Joseph. Joseph also explained that he believed that he was a designated individual to help the Catholic Church get rid of John. Designation was to stop pedophilia in church. Joseph tried to plead not guilty by reason of insanity due to his own molestation, but was denied because of this, because this isn't really a factor as to being insane. In 2007, security video footage of the whole incident between Joseph and John was uploaded online. It shows the cell door and all of the police trying to enter the cell door, and actually shows John's body coming out of the cell when they finally pry the door open. It is unknown who posted it, but it shows all of it. Pinning Joseph down and arresting him, all of it. You can look that online. I'm not putting it in here, but you can look at it. It's on YouTube. But it's not the inmates or anybody, because the inmates don't have access to the footage. They don't have access to internet in this facility, so it is unknown who posted this video. Joseph was given a second life sentence for the murder of John Geoghan. Children who experience sexual trauma undergo a lot of depression or anxiety. This could develop over time. Also sexual dysfunction or sexual obsession. Sexual trauma can also lead to substance abuse with drugs or alcohol. And it's just this one person, this one man caused that in over 150 children. Not saying that all of these children had something like that, like some kind of trauma like that. It doesn't say if all of them did. The ratio and odds are at least multiple of those victims. One of the victims actually was in an interview and explained that he suffered really bad anxiety attacks because of what John did to him when he was younger. And this was years and years after the priest had molested him. So it doesn't just, like, you don't just have trauma immediately afterwards. It just develops, and everybody has their own way of dealing with trauma. And a lot of people have a different way of grieving and getting over that trauma, even if it happens to have a few disorders or something along the way. It's very sad what this man did to so many kids, and a lot of things that go untold. These victims got their justice while this man got to go to jail for them, but a lot of cases go untold and they don't go into courts and stuff like that. So there's a lot of kids that have had to deal with it without getting the justice that they deserve. What do we think? What do we think about this case? Exactly how, honestly, how do we feel? Because I'm torn. There's so many things that could have been prevented with this case that wasn't. And I think that's the part that pisses me off the most. There were so many children, but there were so many people covering for John. I understand sending him to facilities for treatment, but he should have been sent to a correctional facility, not, hey, you did this, oh, let's not talk about it. Let's just send you over here. You're gonna get paid sick leave for molesting so many children. That part of people covering it up is the most bizarre to me. It just hurts my heart because of how disgusting this case is. Again, if this video was a lot and you have made it this far, I'm so sorry that it was such a dark subject. I feel like this case has kind of been pushed away because I didn't know about this case until I was researching it. I knew that there have always been like the stereotypes and rumors about it, but I didn't know that it actually happened. There's also multiple cases of this, and it just angers me. So if you like this video, please be sure to like and subscribe and tell your friends. Yeah, I love you guys so much. I appreciate every single one of you. Thank y'all so much for over 500 subscribers. From my last video, I have gained 150 subscribers. We were just at 300 and now I'm over 500. I'm so excited and I'm so thankful. So yeah, again, thank you guys. Love you guys so much. And I will see you next Thursday. Bye.